Hello there, amazing people. Yeah, press input or input. We are going to look at probably the most advanced operating system that have ever been made or are being made right now. And why am I saying this? Well, you're looking at it right here. It's called haiku-os. This system, a lot of the things about this system came about from the good old 90s, late 90s, early 2000s. Back then, this operating system, you know, the technology behind this operating system, or BOS as it was called, was so ahead of its time that Windows and Linux are just keeping up with it today. Or kind of keeping up with it. Some of the things, when I say kind of keeping up with it, it means that some things got started development early on, but today it's regarded stable, or it's being widely used. Where under BOS, haiku-os, it's been a thing for, well, decades. And yes, you may say, oh my god, you fool, the UI looks really, really awful. And I will kind of agree with you. This is like, this in the 90s, early 2000s, we would be like having the biggest nerd boner and throwing out our girlfriends and stuff like that and marry this fucking UI, because this was kind of like, this was like looking at Pantheon or macOS, how we look at it today, sweet, beautiful, sexy, amazing, and stuff like that. It still resembles, like, if you are a 90s person, if you grew up in the 90s with computers in the 90s, you would understand this. You would understand this UI. It's just not holding up in today's world. It's really not. I'm sorry to say that. If we go in here, we take a little bit trip down history lane here. BOS, as you can see, and there will be some screen tearing, it's not that well run on virtual hardware. For as advanced as this is, it has a lot of drawbacks. It's not really meant for run as a full-time operating system. It lacks application support. The compositor is really iffy. There's no native AMD and NVIDIA support. But the kernel, which we're not going to talk much about today, could make a whole video about the kernel. The file system, the package manager, the file system package manager is what we're going in a little bit into today. Really, really briefly look into it. It's stuff that we're just doing like the last, let's be generous, 10 years is something that like we're starting to do that under Windows or at least Linux, which is mind-boggling when you think about this is BOS here. You know, this came out in the mid-90s to early 2000s. I think the last version was in 2001 or something like that. So what do I mean about it being really, really advanced? Well, right now it's called haiku-os. It basically took BOS, a proprietary company software, made proprietary code, and then they, how can I put it in a good way? They reversed engineered some code, or, well, they actually did that in some cases, but in other cases, they borrowed some really smart developers, meaning there were B developers helping, or BOS developers, let me call it that, because what do we mean by B developers? Well, BOS was made by a company called B, so when BOS kind of defuncted or closed down, some developers, they lended either their expertise, or they re-engineered or reversed engineered their own code for OpenBFS, the Open B file system, which is we are using here under haiku and another other technology and stuff like that. And some got hands on code in the wild. There's a lot of, not well, it's legal, but you know, some gray area had happened, and nobody's really doing anything about it, because the CEO of B kind of wants to see this, and he talks at haiku convention and still B conventions today and stuff like that. But yeah, it's made by this little company here, not company, but organization here, and it's been going on since, I can't remember when haiku started out. Maybe we should use DuckDuckGo to search to figure that out, when it started out. 2000, or it became self-hosting in 2008. 2002 it started out, so it's really, really, really slowly developed, but they have almost, well, they do have developers, but they don't have many developers. It's a niche operating system. BOS was a niche operating system, and there's a lot of great history with BOS. It was actually meant to be installed natively on, I think it was Sony computers, but then Microsoft had a hasty fit and sued everyone, and there's a whole fucking video we can do about that. We all know Microsoft of the 90s. They were Microsoft or go home. If this operating system have the same development power behind it as Linux has, on the desktop, this is a desktop operating system. This is not meant to be server or IoT device, even though with the microkernel that they're using and the whole structure that the OS is built up on, it would probably be a amazing IoT device, which actually what BOS did, the BIoT version of it. Can't remember what it's called right now. It would be way better macOS and Linux for IoT devices. And like I said, had this just had 50% of the development power behind it, it could outcompete Linux in a heartbeat on the desktop. Because it's somewhat POSIX compatible. It's giving you all the freedoms of Linux with the convenience of a user-friendly operating system. It would just decimate Linux on the desktop. You can install this OS. I do it sometimes on my live stream. You can install this OS with... I've installed some applications, but you can get a fully blown OS from zero to I'm doing stuff in under a minute. Think about this. You can have a blank hard drive, and with modern SSDs and all of this jazz, you can get this environment, this system up and running in under a minute. So with all of my shit on it, you know, we have a RAM file system, packets file system. We'll get into that in a little bit. The B file system, it's OpenBF, but you can kind of see here. You can get this up and running on let's just say a little over a minute, but it's still massively fast. And here I use DF because it's Unix like POSIX compatible or POSIX whatever you would call it. A lot of the same command under Linux work on it. We have GTK support on it. There is Qt support on it. This is the biggest party piece ever, man. I can turn on and off a process, and I'm only running a 3-processor system. Now I'm only running a 2-core system. Now I'm running a 4-core system. You can turn cores on and off without having to reboot or anything. I dare you to do this under Windows Linux, FreeBSD, macOS without it slapping you in the face and calling you its little fucking homie slave bitch and pooping all over the place. Haiku is just like, yeah, okay, you don't want to use this process or this core, fine by me, I'm just disabling it. What do you know, why is this fool here telling you guys and girls that this is probably the most advanced OS? Let's look a little bit at, you know, applications. Self-contained archives, and not fully self-contained, a little bit of a cap, but just think about this a little bit, about these ideas we're talking about here. Let's look a little bit about how they are set up. You know, they're using something called HPKT, the Haiku packets format. So to get the packets installed on their Haiku computer, a user will download a package file in the format called HPG. The user will typically do this via Haiku Depot, desktop application, or by using pacman command line. Once the HPKG, file is downloaded and moved into its place, system-packages, they put them a little bit, you know, there are two main places put it. The content of the package appears read-only in the file system, and then you have an example here, which would provide necessary files for the proper PE text editor. So what the short and the long of it is that we have an order container, and we have uncompressed structure and all of these kind of things. But you kind of saw it a little bit here. Packets.fs. Where have we seen a packets format basically running the packets in a containerized fashion and then mounted it as a read-only file system? I'm thinking flat packages, snap packages. It's like oh my god, this is the new thing under Linux. It's like magical and all that. You know, and to some extent, Mac OS have had kind of what the app images is, you know, a self-contained package file. And you talk about a little bit here that how it's built up with like a header file, a heap file, a table of contents file, packet attribute, and blah, 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 blah. It's not totally like snap packages and flat packages, but it bears a lot of similarities to it. And you can go down here and you can see, we can scroll down here and see how it's done. Here's a meta package, basically the package info list. This here looks a lot like how to build a snap package, to be honest. And we are all right now sitting and praising Linux for being this amazing OS that have these universal package formats. When in reality, well, Mac has had it forever, and Haiku or BOS have had it forever. And if you look at how this is built up, and you go and read more into the documentation, it's a lot like snap and flat packages, like a lot. Well, let's go a little bit further here with the B file system, BOF file system, which OpenBFS or the version that we are running under Haiku here is. This is like one of the really fascinating thing here. BFS was developed by these two people here over a 10-month period starting in September. So give BOS a modern 64-bit operating set. I can't speak. 64-bit capable journal file system. It is case sensitive and capable of being used on floppy hard drives and read-only media and blah, 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 blah. But if you look at the spec sheet over here, 25 years ago, dictionary contents, B plus T is a M array tray with a variable, but often large number of children per node. A B plus tree consists of a root, internal nodes, and levels. The root may be either a leaf or a node. You get what I'm coming at here. File associates nodes. Limits max volume size. It's two... It's a byte, or what are they calling it? Exabyte? Max file size is 260 gigabytes. Maximum numbers of files limited. Max file name length 255. Let's look at BTIFS, which is the new kind of... Oh my god! BTIFS is the new fucking... Oh! Well, it's also a B-tree. The file allocation is extended. What was it on the BOS? It was inodes. Max volume 16 gigabytes. I can't fucking remember what this is. And max file size, again 16. What was it on the BOS? It was a B file system. 260 gigabytes. So they are, of course, bigger. Max number of files, it just says 2 here. Yeah, and then you have the file length and stuff like that. But if you look at it here, the BTIFS, border file system, B3 file system, or whatever the fuck you will call it, it's basically just a souped up fucking version of the BFS file system. It's a natural progression of a file system, if you think about it, that was done 25 years ago. And I don't know when BTIFS was made. It was made 14 years ago. BOS still exists today. They will probably have a way more advanced version of the BTIFS file system. More storage support, more max volume support and stuff like that. Because they already had the foundation in here. You also have to remember that BTIFS is made for servers. So they have a lot of tools in there that makes sense for servers, but not really the desktop. BTIFS, don't fool you, it's not meant as a home desktop file system. It was built purposely for file servers and stuff like that. That don't mean you can't use it at home. It's just not purposely built for that. The B file system was purposely built for home. We have different requirements than a server file system has. We have different requirements than they have. We have different use cases than they have. But it's still fascinating to think about that our operating system in 1997 had basically a slimmed down version of the BTIFS file system that makes sense for desktops. So Linux file systems, what did we use back in... So I will go out of my memory. I may miss a file system. So we had like EXT. This was the most used file system back in the extended file system. EXT2, EXT3, when did they came out? So this was kind of what... Yeah. EXT2 and 3 was kind of what we had back, we used back in the day. Most was using EXT2, to be honest. But if we then look at the comparisons here, it was lacklustering. Even Windows was lacklustering for the B file system in those days. We also had something called Riser FS before he murdered his whole family. That was also using a B3. So this was closer to BTIFS. Closer to the B5 system from BOS. People used, I think, in the 90s and early 2000s was mostly EXT2 because it was more mature and stuff like that. And then EXT3 kind of took off in like 2000, mid-2000s. Don't quote me on this, but it's just from my recollection from the times back then. But you think about it, that's just the file system and the package management system. Not to talk about this down here. You can still not do that under Windows and Linux. Let me go back to a one-core system. Let me open some things here so you can see what's going on. I'm just using one core. Let's use two cores. Now we're using two cores. Let's use three cores. Still can't do that under Windows, Linux, Mac OS, or any other operating system as far as I know. Probably some real-time operating systems like QNX and stuff like that. But again, you could do this in the fucking mid-90s. I find this highly interesting. I have to talk for 35 minutes now, and I don't know what the full length of this video is when I'm done editing it. But I could talk for like 30 hours about haiku and BOS. Maybe I should do another live stream about this system. I do it once in a while. If you want more content about this system, let me know, and especially what you want to know about it. It's hard for me to guess what you want to know about this system. So if you want videos about this system, I will probably make them and then put them in like as a bonus video throughout the week. See you all later. Have an amazing day. Bye-bye.